Book 8, The Angel Ended. And in Adam's ear so charming left his voice that a while thought him still speaking, still stood fixed to hear. Then his new waked thus gratefully replied, "What thanks sufficient or what recompense equal have I to render thee, divine historian, who thus largely hast allayed the thirst I had of knowledge, and vouchsafed this friendly condescension to relate things else by me unsearchable, now heard with wonder, but delight, and is as due with glory attributed to the high Creator. Something yet a doubt remains, which only thy solution can resolve, when I behold this goodly frame, this world of heaven and earth consisting, and compute their magnitudes, this earth a spot, a grain, an atom, with the firmament compared in all her numbered stars, that seem to roll spaces incomprehensible, for such their distance argues, and their swift return diurnal, merely to officiate light round this opacious earth, this punctual spot, one day and night, in all their vast survey useless besides, reasoning I oft admire, how nature wise and frugal could commit such disproportions, which superfluous hands so many nobler bodies to create, greater so manifold did this one use, for aught appears, and on their orbs impose such restless revolution day by day repeated, while the sedentary earth, that better might with far less compass move, served by her more noble than herself, attains her end without least motion, and receives as tribute such a sumless journey broad of incorporeal speed her warmth and light. Speed to describe whose swiftness number fails." So spake our sire, and by his countenance seemed entering on studious thoughts abstruse, which Eve, perceiving where she sat retired in sight, with lowliness majestic from her seat, and grace that one who saw to wish her stay, rose and went forth among her fruits and flowers, to visit how they prospered, bud and bloom, her nursery. They at her coming sprung, and touched by her fair tendance, gladlier grew. Yet went she not, as not with such discourse delighted, not capable her ear of what was high. Such pleasure she reserved, Adam relating, the sole auditress. Her husband, the relator, she preferred before the angel, of him to ask chose rather. He, she knew, would intermix grateful discretions, and solve high dispute with conjugal caresses, from his lip not words alone pleased her. Oh, when meet now such pairs, in love and mutual honor joined, with goddess-like demeanor she forth she went, not unattended, for on her as queen a pomp of willing graces waited still, and from about her shot darts of desire into all eyes to wish her still in sight. And Raphael now to Adam's doubt proposed, benevolent facile thus replied, "To ask or search I blame thee not, for heaven is as the book of God before thee set, wherein to read his wondrous works and learn in seasons, hours, or days, or months, or years. This to attain, whether heaven move or earth, imports not, if thou reckon right, the rest from man or angel the great architect did wisely to conceal, and not divulge his secrets to be scanned by them who ought rather admire. Nor if they list to try conjecture, he is fabric of the heavens hath left to their disputes, perhaps to move his laughter at their quaint opinions wide hereafter, when they come to model heaven and calculate the stars, how they will wield the mighty frame, how build, unbuild, contrive to save appearances, how gird the sphere with centric and eccentric scribbled over, circle and epicycle, orb and orb. Already by thy reasoning this I guess, who art to lead thy offspring, and supposest the bodies bright and greater should not serve the less not bright, nor heaven such journeys run, earth sitting still, when she alone receives the benefit. Consider first, that greater bright infers not excellence, the earth, though in comparison of heaven so small, so not nor glistering, may of solid good contain more plenty than the sun that barren shines, whose work on itself works no effect, but in the fruitful earth. There first received his beams, unactive else, their vigor fine. Yet not to earth are those bright luminaries officious, but to thee, earth's inhabitant. And for heaven's wide circuit, let it speak the Maker's high magnificence, who built so spacious and his line stretched out so far that man may dwell as he knows not in his own, an edifice too large for him to fill, lodged in a small partition, and the rest ordained for uses to his Lord best known. The swiftness of those circles attributes, though numberless, to his omnipotence, that to corporeal substance could add speed almost spiritual. Me thou think'st not slow, who since the morning hours set out from heaven where God resides, and ere midday arrived in Eden, distance inexpressible by numbers that have name. But this I urge, admitting motion to the heavens, to show invalid that which thee to doubt it moved. Not that I so affirm, though so it seemed to thee who hast thy dwelling here on earth. God remove his ways from human sense, placed heaven from earth so far, the earthly sight, if it presume, might err in things too high, no advantage gain. What if the sun be center of the world, and other stars by his attractive virtue in their own incited dance about him various rounds? Their wandering course, now high, now low, now hid, progressive, retrograde, or standing still. In sixth thou seest, and what if seventh to these, the planet Earth, so steadfast as she seems, insensibly three different motions move, which else to several spheres thou must ascribe, move contrary with thwart obliquities, there save the sun his labor in that swift nocturnal and diurnal rhyme supposed, invisible else above all stars, the wheel of day and night, which needs not thy belief, if earth industrious of herself fetch day travelling east, and with her part averse from the sun's beam meet night, her other part still luminous by his ray. What if that other light sent from earth through that wide transpicuous star to the terrestrial moon be as a star enlightening her by day, and she by night this earth? Reciprocal, if land be there, fields and inhabitants, her spots thou seest as clouds, and clouds may rain, and rain produce fruits in the softened soil for some to eat allotted there. And other suns, perhaps, with their attendant moons thou wilt descry, communicating male and female light, which two great sexes animate the world, stored in each orb, perhaps, with some that live. For such vast room in nature unpossessed by living soul, desert and desolate only to shine with scarce to contribute, each orb a glimpse of light conveyed so far down to this habitable, which returns light back to them, is obvious to dispute. The whether thus these things or whether not, whether the sun predominant in heaven rise on the earth, or the earth rise on the sun, he from the east his flaming road begin, or she from the west her silent course advance with inoffensive pace, the spinning sleeps on a soft axle, while she paces even and bears the soft with the smooth air along. Solicit not thy thoughts with matter hid, leave them to God above, him serve and fear. Of other creatures, as him pleases best, wherever placed, let him dispose. Joy thou in what he gives to thee, this paradise and thy fair Eve. Heaven is for thee too high to know what passes there. Be lowly wise. Think only what concerns thee in thy being. Dream not of other worlds, what creatures there live, and in what state, condition, or degree. Contented that thus far hast been revealed, not of earth only, but of highest heaven. To whom thus Adam, cleared of doubt, replied, "How fully hast thou satisfied me, pure intelligence of heaven, angel serene and freed from intricacies, taught to live the easiest way, nor with perplexing thoughts to interrupt the sweet of life, from which God hath bid dwell far off all anxious cares, and not molest us, unless we ourselves seek them with wandering thoughts and notions vain. But apt the mind or fancy is to rove unchecked, and ever roving is no end. Till warned or by experience taught, she learned not to know at large of things remote from use, obscure and subtle, but to know that which before us lies in daily life is the prime wisdom. What is more is fume, or emptiness, or fond impertinence, and renders us in things that most concern unpracticed, unprepared, and still to seek. Therefore, from this high pitch, let us descend to lower flights, and speak of things at hand useful, which haply mention may arise of something not unseasonable to ask by sufferance, and thy wanted favor deigned. Thee I have relating what was done ere my remembrance. Now relate, hear me relate my story, which perhaps thou hast not heard. The day is not yet spent. Till then thou seest how subtly to detain thee I devise, inviting thee to hear why I relate, fond, were it not in hope of thy reply. For while I sit with thee, I seem in heaven, and sweeter thy discourse is to my ear than fruits of palm tree, pleasantest to thirst and hunger both, from labor, at the hour of sweet repast. They satiate and soon fill, though pleasant, but thy words with grace divine imbued bring to their sweetness no satiety. To whom thus Raphael answered, heavenly meek, nor thy lips ungraceful, sire of men, nor tongue ineloquent, for God on thee abundantly his gifts all hath also poured inward and outward both, his image fair. Speaking or mute, all comeliness and grace attends thee, and each word, each motion forms. Nor less we think we in heaven of thee on earth than of our fellow servant, and inquire gladly into the ways of God with man. For God we see hath honored thee, and set on man his equal love. Say therefore on. For I that day was absent, as befell, bound on a voyage uncouth and obscure, far on excursion towards the gates of hell, squared in full legion, such command we had, to see that none thence issued forth a spy or enemy, while God was in his work, lest he incensed at the eruption bold, destruction with creation might have mixed. Not that they durst without his leave attempt, but us he sends on that his high behest for state as sovereign king, and to inure our prompt obedience. Fast we found, fast shut the dismal gates and barricadoed strong, but long ere our approaching heard within noise other than the song of dance or song, torment and loud lament and furious rage. Glad we returned up to the coast of light ere Sabbath evening, for so we had in charge, but thy relation now. For I attend, pleased with thy words, no less than thou with mine. So spake the godlike power, and thus our sire. For man to tell how human life began is hard, for who himself beginning knew. Desire with thee still longer to converse induced me. As new waked from soundest sleep, soft in a flowery herb, I found me laid in balmy sweat, which with his beams the sun soon dried, and on the reeking moisture fed. Straight toward heaven my wondering eyes I turned, and gazed awhile the ample sky, till raised by quick instinctive motion, up I sprung, this thitherward endeavoring, and upright stood on my feet. About me round I saw a hill, dale, and shady woods, and sunny plains, and liquid laps of murmuring streams. by these creatures that lived and moved and walked or flew, birds on the branches warbling. All things smiled with fragrance and with joy. My heart overflowed. Myself I then perused, limb by limb surveyed, and sometimes went and sometimes ran with supple joints as lively vigor led. But who I was or where, or from what cause, knew not. To speak I tried, and forthwith spake. My tongue obeyed, and readily could name whatever I saw. Thou sun, said I, fair light, and thou enlightened earth, so fresh and gay, ye hills and dales, ye rivers, woods, and plains, and ye that live and move, fair creatures, tell if you saw, how came I thus, how here? Not of myself, but some great maker then, in goodness and in power preeminent. Tell me how I may know him, how adore, from whom I have, that thus I move and live, and feel that I am happier than I know. While thus I called and strayed, I knew not whither, from where I first drew air and first beheld this happy light, when answer none returned, on a green shady bank profuse of shower flowers, pensive I sat me down. There gentle sleep first found me, and with soft oppression seized my drowsed sense, untroubled, though I thought I was then passing my former state insensible and forthwith to dissolve, when suddenly at my head a dream, whose inward apparition gently moved my fancy to believe I yet had being and lived. One came, methought, of shape divine, and said, thy mansion once thee, Adam, rise! First man, of man innumerable ordained first father, called by thee I come thy guide to the garden of bliss, thy seat prepared. So saying, by the hand he took me raised, and over fields and waters, as in air smooth sliding without step, last led me up a woody mountain, whose high top was plain, a circuit wide and closed, with goodliest trees planted, with walks and bowers, that what I saw of earth before scarce pleasant seemed. Each tree loaded with fairest fruit that hung to the eye tempting stirred in me sudden appetite to pluck and eat, whereat I waked and found my before mine eye all real, this dream had lively shadowed. Here had new begun my wandering, had not he who was my guide up hither from among the trees appeared, presence divine. Rejoicing, but with awe and adoration at his feet, I fell submiss. He reared me, and whom thou sought'st I am, said mildly, the author of all this thou seest above, around, about thee, or beneath. This paradise I give thee, count it thine to till and keep, and of the fruit to eat. Of every tree that in the garden grows, eat freely with glad heart. Fear here no dearth. But of the tree whose operation brings knowledge of good and ill, which I have set the pledge of thy obedience and thy faith, amid the garden by the tree of life, remember what I warn thee, shun the taste, and shun the bitter consequence. For know, the day thou eatest thereof, my soul command transgress, and inevitably thou shalt die. From that day mortal, in this happy state shalt lose, expelled from hence into a world of woe and sorrow. Sternly he pronounced the rigid interdiction, which resounds yet dreadful in mine ear, though in my choice not to incur. But soon his clear aspect returned, and gracious purpose thus renewed. Not only these fair bounds, but all the earth to thee and to thy race I give. As lords possess it, and all things that therein live, or live in sea or air, bird, beast, fish, and fowl, and sign whereof each bird and beast behold after their kinds. I bring them to receive from thee their names, and pay thee fealty with low subjection. Understand the same of fish within their watery residence, not hither summoned, since they cannot change their element to draw the thinner air. As thus he spake, each bird and beast behold approaching two and two, these cowering low with blandishment, each bird stooped on his wing. I named them, and they passed, and understood their nature, and with such knowledge God endued my sudden apprehension. But in these I found not what methought I wanted still, to the heavenly vision thus presumed. O, by what name, and for thou art above all these, above mankind, and aught that mankind higher surpassed far my naming, how may I adore thee, author of this universe, and all this good demand, for whose well-being so amply and with hands so liberal thou hast provided all things? But with me I see not who partakes. In solitude, what happiness! Who can enjoy alone, or all enjoying, what contentment find? This I presumptuous, and the vision bright is with a smile more brightened thus replied. What callest thou solitude? Is not the earth with various living creatures, and the air replenished, and all these at thy command to come and play before thee? Knowest thou not their language and their ways? They also know, and reason not contemptibly, with these fine pastime and bare rule. Thy realm is large. So spake the universal Lord, and seemed so ordering. I with leave of speech implored, and humble deprecation thus replied. Let not my words offend thee, heavenly power, my maker, be propitious while I speak. Hast thou not made me here thy substitute, and these inferior far beneath me set? Among unequals, what society consort, what heaven, harmony, or true delight, which must be mutual, in proportion due, given and received? But in disparity, the one intense, the other still remiss, cannot well suit with either, but soon prove tedious alike. Of fellowship I speak, such as I seek, fit to participate all rational delight, wherein the brute cannot be human consort. They rejoice each with their own kind, lion with lioness. So fitly them in pairs thou hast combined. Much less can bird with beast and fish with fowl so well converse, nor with the ox the ape. Worse then can man with beast, and least of all. Whereto the Almighty answered, not displeased, a nice and subtle happiness I see thou to thyself proposest, in the choice of thy associates, Adam, and will taste no pleasure, though in pleasure solitary. What think'st thou then of me, in this my state? Seem I to thee sufficiently possessed of happiness or not? Whom am alone from all eternity? For none I know second to me or like, equal much less. How have I then with whom to hold converse, save with the creatures which I made, and those to me inferior, infinite descents beneath which other creatures are to thee? He ceased, and I lowly answered, to attain the height and depth of thy eternal ways, all human thoughts must come short, supreme of things. Thou in thyself art perfect, and in thee is no deficience found. Not so in man, but in degree, the cause of his desire, by conversation with his like to help or solace his defects. No need that thou shouldst propagate, already infinite, and through all numbers absolute, the one. But man by number is to manifest his single imperfection, and beget like of his like, his image multiplied, and in unity defective, which requires collateral love and dearest amity. Thou in thy secrecy, although alone, best with thyself accompanied, seek'st not social communication, yet so pleased canst raise thy creature to what height thou wilt of union or communion deified. I, by conversing, cannot these erect from prone, nor in their ways complacent find. Thus I emboldened spake, and freedom used permissive and acceptance found, which gained this answer from the gracious voice divine. Thus far to try thee, Adam, I was pleased, and find thee knowing not of brute beasts alone, which thou hast rightly named, but of thyself, expressing well the spirit within thee free, my image, not imparted to the brute, whose fellowship therefore unmeet for thee good reason was thou freely shouldst dislike, and be so minded still. I, ere thou spakest, knew it was not good for man to be alone. No such company as then thou sawest intended thee, for trial only brought, to see how thou couldst judge of fit and meet. What next I bring shall please thee, be assured, thy likeness, thy fit help, thy other self, thy wish, exactly to thy heart's desire. He ended, there I heard no more, for now my earthly by his heavenly overpowered, which it had long stood under, strained the heights in that celestial colloquy sublime, as with an object that excels the sense, dazzled and spent, sunk down, and sought repair of sleep, which instantly fell on me, called by nature as an aid, and closed my eyes. Mine eyes he closed, but open left the cell of fancy, my internal sight, by which, abstract as in a trance, methought I saw, though sleeping where I lay, and saw the shape still glorious before whom awake I stood, though who stooping oped my left side and took from thence a rib, with cordial spirits warm and life-blood streaming fresh. Wide was the wound, but suddenly the flesh filled up and was healed. The rib he formed and fashioned with his hands. Under his forming hands a creature grew, manlike, but different sex, so lovely fair that what seemed fair in all the world seemed now mean, or in her summed up, in her contained and in her looks, which from that time infused sweetness into my heart, unfelt before, and into all things from her air inspired the spirit of love and amorous delight. She disappeared and left me dark. I waked to find her, or forever to deplore her loss and other pleasures all abjure. When out of hope behold her, not far off, such as I saw her in my dream, adorned with what all earth or heaven could bestow to make her amiable. On she came, guided by his voice, not uninformed by nuptial sanctity and marriage rites. Grace was in all her steps, heaven in her eye, in every gesture, dignity and love. I, overjoyed, could not forbear aloud. This turn hath make amends. Thou hast fulfilled thy words, Creator, bounteous and benign, giver of all things fair, but fairest this of all thy gifts, nor enviest. Now I see, bone to my bone, flesh to my flesh, myself before me. Woman is her name, the man extracted. For this cause he shall forgo father and mother, and to his wife adhere, and they shall be one flesh, one heart, one soul. She heard me thus, and though divinely brought, yet innocence and virgin modesty, her virtue and conscious of her worth, that would be wooed and not unsought be won, not obvious, not obtrusive, but retired, the more desirable, or to say all nature herself, though pure of sinful thought, wrought in her so, that seeing me she turned. I followed her. She what was honor knew, and with obsequious majesty approved my pleaded reason. To the nuptial bower I led her, blushing like the morn. All heaven and all constellations on that hour shed their selectest influence. The earth gave sign of gratulation in each hill. Joyous the birds, fresh gales and gentle airs whispered it to the woods, and from their wings flung rose, flung odors from the spicy shrub disporting, till the amorous bird of night sung spousal, and bid haste the evening star on his hilltop to light the bridal lamp. Thus I have told thee all my state, and brought my story to the sum of earthly bliss which I enjoy, and must confess to find in all things else delight indeed. But such as used or not works in the mind no change, nor vehement desire, such delicacies I mean of taste, sight, smell, herbs, fruits, and flowers, walks and the melody of birds. But here far otherwise transported I behold, transported touch, Here passion first I felt, commotion strange, and in all enjoyments else superior and unmoved, here only weak against the charm of beauty's powerful glance. Or nature failed in me, and left some part not proof enough such object to sustain, there from my side subducting took perhaps more than enough, there at least on her bestowed too much of ornament, an outward show elaborate, of inward less exact. For well I understand in the prime end of nature her the inferior, in the mind and inward faculties which most excel, in outward also her resembling less his image who made both, and less expressing the character of that dominion given though the other creatures. Yet when I approach her loveliness, so absolute she seems, and in herself complete, so well to know what her own, that what she wills to say or do seems wisest, virtuousest, discreetest, best. All higher knowledge in her presence falls degraded. Wisdom in discourse with her loses discountenance, like folly shows. Authority and reason on her weight is one intended first, not after made occasionally. And to consummate all, greatness of mind and nobleness their seat build in her loveliest, and create an awe about her, is a guard angelic placed. To whom the angel with contracted brow, accuse not nature, she had done her part, do thou but thine. Be not diffident of wisdom, she deserts thee not, if thou dismiss her not, when thou most needs her nigh, by attributing overmuch to things less excellent, as thou thyself perceiv'st. For what admirest thou, and what transports thee so, and outside? Fair, no doubt, and worthy well thy cherishing, thy honoring, and thy love, not thy subjection. Weigh with her thyself, then value. Oft times nothing profits more than self-esteem, grounded unjust and right well managed. Of that skill the more thou knowest, the more will she acknowledge thee her head, and to realities yield all her shows. Made so adorned for thy delight the more, so awful, that with honor thou mayest love thy mate, who seest when thou art seen least wise. But if the sense of touch whereby mankind is propagated seems such dear delight beyond all other, think the same vouchsafe to cattle and each beast, which would not be to them made common and divulged, if aught therein enjoyed were worthy to subdue the soul of man, or passion in him move. What higher in her society thou find'st attractive human rational love still, loving thou dost well, in passion not, wherein true love consists not. Love refines the thoughts, and the heart enlarges, hath his seat in reason, and is judicious, is the scale by which to heavenly love thou mayest ascend, not sunk in carnal pleasure, for which cause among the beasts no mate for thee was found. To whom thus half abashed Adam replied, neither her outside forms are so fair, nor aught in procreation common to all kinds, the higher of the genial bed by far, and with mysterious reverence I deem, so much delights me, as those graceful acts, those thousand decencies that daily flow from all her words and actions, mingled with love and sweet compliance, which dare unfeigned union of mind, nor in us both one soul. Harmony but to behold in wedded pair more grateful than harmonious sound to the ear. Yet these subject not, I to thee disclose what inward thence I feel, not therefore foiled, who meet with various objects from the sense various representing, yet still free, approve the rest and follow what I approve. To love thou blames me not, for love thou sayest leads up to heaven, is both the way and guide. Bear with me then, if lawful what I ask, love not the heavenly spirits, and how their love express they, if by looks only, or do they mix irradiance, virtual or immediate touch? To whom the angel with a smile that glowed celestial rosy red, love's proper hue, answered, "Let it suffice thee that thou knowest us happy, and without love no happiness. Whatever pure thou in the body enjoyest, and pure thou were created, we enjoy in eminence. An obstacle find none of membrane, joint, or limb, exclusive bars. Easier than air with air of spirits embrace, total they mix, union of pure with pure desiring. Nor restrained conveyance need of flesh to mix with flesh, or soul with soul. But I can now no more. The parting sun beyond the earth's green cape and verdant isles Hesperian sets my signal to depart. Be strong, live happy in love, but first of all, him who to love is to obey and keep his great command. Take heed lest passion sway thy judgment to do aught which else free will would not admit. Thine and of all thy sons, the weal or woe in thee is placed. Beware. I in thy persevering shall rejoice, and all the blessed stand fast. To stand or fall free in thine own arbitrament it lies, perfect within, no outward aid require, and all temptation to transgress repel. So saying he arose, whom Adam thus followed with benediction. Since depart, go, heavenly guest, ethereal messenger, sent from whose sovereign goodness I adore. Gentle to me and affable hath been thy condescension, and shall be honored ever with grateful memory. Thou to mankind be good and friendly still, and oft return. So parted they, the angel up to heaven from the thick shade, and Adam to his bower. The end of the...